good morning. We are glad to have you with us this morning. Let's stand together as we sing about the majesty of our Lord. Majesty, kingdom authority. Let's sing together.
Good to see all of you here this morning in our worship service, and all of you that are watching our Facebook Live program. We want to thank you for being a part of our worship service here at First Baptist Chatsworth. So glad to see all of the global folks. I believe all of you are visiting from above the mountain, and so we're glad to have you here and Christian. And we have a number of our young people that went to youth camp that are here, even those who are visiting from other churches and their families, and we're so grateful that all of you are here with us this morning, and hope you feel at home and enjoy our service this morning. Have just a couple of announcements I want to make, and then we will get right into our service. First of all, do not forget, today is your deadline on your Appalachian Backpack project, and those of you that are giving to that, be sure and see Miss Terry Floyd. Also, I want to remind you of the baby shower that's going to be taking place. That'll be downstairs, as many of you will drive through from 2 to 4, and you'll just drive through the breezeway area, and there'll be someone there that will point you in the right direction, and you'll give gifts, and there'll be all kinds of wonderful things of waving and shouting, and maybe we'll have a megaphone down there for them to communicate. Give you a megaphone, they can communicate. Because we have to take those type of precautions, but we are so grateful that we're able to do it. Also, want to remind you on August the 9th, Murray County High School football team will be here with us in service. And so we're going to try to green out that day instead of blackout. Spoke to Coach Brewer this week, and they're planning on being here for our morning service, and we're excited about them being here. And so you be sure and make plans to be here and to support the Murray County football team. With that being said, I'm going to have a word of prayer, and Brother Ray is going to come, and he's going to introduce all of the other festivities that are going to be taking place this morning. So let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we love you and thank you for the blood of Jesus Christ, your Son, that continually cleanses us from all sin. We thank you that when we approach you, we don't have to do it with a righteousness that is of our own, but a righteousness that has been given to us as a garment and a gift by faith in Jesus Christ. Lord, we approach you in his holiness, in his perfection, and we ask you to bless this service this morning. Fill us with your Spirit. Forgive us and cleanse us where we failed you, and restore that sweet fellowship that we know so well. I pray, Heavenly Father, that you would be with Ray and all of the youth as they get up and speak. Be with Christian and those that are going to be singing this morning. And fill me with your Spirit as we open up your Word and share the truth of Scripture. We thank you that in your word we find truth. It is truly a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. We can't thank you enough for it. In Christ's name, amen and amen.
Thank you, Pastor Mark. Well, July 6th to the 10th, we went to youth camp. And I forgot to grab mine. So there we go. We went to youth camp and was grateful for the opportunity to go and have the opportunity to have some type of normalcy
through what has been a crazy, crazy year. And as we went, the theme of camp was accelerate. Accelerate based on the book of Mark and the fact that we got to go forward because only Jesus saves. And the idea of thinking about, regardless of the things that are happening in this world, regardless of what is happening in this time where there's still a primary purpose, what we're supposed to be about as a church and as Christians. So what do? You learn to look through and accelerate. When you look through the book, Gospel of Mark, there is constantly the theme of going to the next stage, Jesus going to the next thing, Jesus going to the next thing. It's this almost this quick overview of Jesus' ministers as he's doing miracles, as he's reaching out to people, as he's healing people, as he's raising people from the dead. And it's in the process and the context of the book of Mark that our whole camp was set about. Our camp is basically set up like this. In a week, we arrive at camp and we're the students from the different churches are kind of put together in ministry teams that they go about and kind of figure out the goal of camp and the secret of camp. There's a theme, drama that goes through the camp. And it's through the camp that it makes an impact in kids' lives. And the reason it does is this, is they have morning small group Bible study. We have morning preaching. They'll have afternoon activities where they can hang out and enjoy each other's company. Then in the evenings they have more small group time. And then again, evening worship services where they come together and kind of put together everything that happens. Some of the highlights for me is something I'm going to share here in just a moment. But for those of you who have never been to camp, I would encourage you, we always usually need chaperones. And you think, well, I might be too old. Listen, you're not too old. We got aspirin, we got ibuprofen, and you can go. Listen, I'm knocking on 50 here before too long. I'll get my AARP card out before too long. So, you can still go. Don't think you're too old not to go. So next year, when we're able to do this, I encourage you to go. This is the oddest camp because this is the smallest group that I've taken probably in all my years of ministry, other than one year I did a middle school only camp. But it's one that God richly blessed in a special way and encouraged me a very special way. So I've got a video put together, a highlight of some of the pictures from the camp, and then also all the students get to share with us. I just didn't make them do it from right here behind the pulpit. So pay attention to the screen as we'll see the highlights of camp.
You are the only king forever. Hi, I'm Ella.
Hi, I'm Reagan.
Hi, I'm Emily.
And this week we went to global youth camps, and God really put on my heart about growing my relationship with Him.
God put on my heart that I need to start trusting Him more and taking more risks.
God put on my heart that I need to start telling people more about Jesus.
Hi, I'm Meredith.
Hi, I'm Anna.
This past week we've been at global camp. My favorite thing about this camp was getting to meet all the new people. And the one thing I've taken away from this camp is that it's okay to admit that you've been broken.
My favorite thing was probably evening worship. I like singing and doing all of that stuff. I liked that a lot. I think God showed me that I need to admit my wrongs and just confess my sins whenever I do something wrong instead of just holding it all inside.
Yeah. Hey, my name is Luke Hedrick. This past week we were at Global Youth Camps, and this week God reminded me to pray for His will to take place instead of my own.
Hey, my name's Connor Marshall. God reminded me that I really wasn't following Him and I was just doing my own thing, and I rededicated my life to Him.
Hey, I'm AJ Keith, and we had a great week, and it was real small here, but God just, He did something, and I rededicated my life.
Hey, I'm Samuel Carr, and God this week showed me that that He loves me, and I didn't love Him like I should have, and He's really working in my life.
Hi, my name is Brett Nell, and God showed me this week that I wasn't really focused on Him. I was focused on my friends. I was focused on everything else other than Him, and that He loved me, so I rededicated my life to Him.
You always learn things about people when you go off to camp. One thing I learned is I sort of felt like I was Frank James with the James Gang while I was having to give out masks to block out our identity as we went about going everywhere. I found out that our pastor's wife has the same ability as my wife of evading camera shots. So as I was going through the literally hundreds of pictures of everybody at camp, no pictures of Sherry. Was Sherry there? I've seen her every day, but there's no pictures. So her and my wife have the same spiritual gift of evading camera shots when we go off to do youth activities. I guess when I think about camp and how important it is and why I felt the need to try to do it this year, even regardless of everything that's going on, is that in the midst of the craziness that this world is pouring into our life, and my personal belief, all of this is from the devil, is there need to be somewhere, something happening where we're getting kids centered on God's word. Of all the debate about what to do, about how to live, about how to do things, there's got to be something where we're trying to get kids centered, get a point where they're focused on God's word. Now, they came back. That was at the first of the month. And I told them when we left, listen, when you come back, the devil is going to hit you real hard, in fact, starting home that day. And what happens is this, is I ask them all to take one thing from camp and to put it into practice, remind them of that, and be reminded what God spoke their life and heart about, because you're going to need that in the coming months and the coming weeks ahead. One of the things that encouraged me most about the camp was to see some of these guys. I've had the privilege to see them come, some of them in children's church, and then go into camp, and then some of them are entering high school, and couple of them will be graduating this year, and that's something that I'm honored to be able to hang around long enough to see that. The other thing I was honored to see was to see Christian leading in worship. And I remember the first year I here, I took him to camp, and I had to tell him to put on deodorant and brush his teeth every day. And now he was actually leading worship with global people at camp. So I was encouraged me in a lot of ways. One of the things that encouraged me most was the last night of camp, the last church group time, I had everybody go through and talk about one thing that God spoke to their heart about, even the adults. And that was an encouraging time. Because we think when we go to youth camp, we do this stuff, it is only really for kids. But if it's only just for kids, then we're missing the point of the Bible, of preaching, of Bible study. It's for all of us, no matter what age we're at. No matter the context that you're learning, hearing God's word, it has applications for all people at all ages, at all settings. And it encouraged me to hear the adults share things that God spoke to them about in a very special way. My prayer is this, is as we go through the rest of the craziness of 2020, is that these students will be reminded of that one thing God spoke to them this week. So we're going to do this. I'm going to ask those that went, not all of them were able to be here this morning, but I want to ask those that came, you can still step on the steps if you don't mind. Clay Swainer was on the other adults. He's up here working on the sound booth, so y'all come on. It's okay. Listen, I took the speaking away from you. You just got to stand here and smile, look pretty. And we're going to do this. I'm going to ask, we also got a special guest, Veronica Franco, who's leading worship, and her and Christian. So you guys come on up here, because I'm going to ask you to do this. They're going to lead us in the song we learned at camp, and maybe you've heard it on the radio called Waymaker, and they're going to lead us in that song in just a minute. So I'm going to ask you to do this. You've been standing for a few minutes. I'm going to ask you, let's go ahead and stand on your feet for a moment. We're going to say a word of prayer over these students. And then they're going to go back and sit down in their seats. I'm going to ask you to remain standing as they lead us in this song, Waymaker, that talks about how God works in our lives to take us to where we need to go and to reach our hearts in a very, very special way. Father, we love you, and we thank you for your grace and mercy. And Father, I thank you for your freedom and allowing us to go to camp. The idea that reminded me, encouraged me that regardless of everything that's going on in the world, I got to be about helping to create disciples. That's my calling. And Father, everything that's happening, everything that's going on, that's got to be the number one priority of what we do. Father, for these students that went, Father, I say a special prayer for them, that you'll continue to speak to their hearts in a special way, and they'll be an igniter in their group of friends and in their homes about the gospel and about being focused on Jesus Christ. For the adults that gave up their time and went and gave up resources out of pocket to win, I appreciate their willingness to go and to be a part of seeing these students grow and make commitments of faith. Father, for a church that's faithfully supporting and faithfully giving through the years to see you students grow. And Father, I'm grateful for this, that you allow me to be a part of it. With all my failings and all my shortcomings, you still allow me to be encouraged and to see students grow and to see adults grow in their faith. Father, I simply ask this. As we sing this song about how you make ways in our life to bring us closer to you, we'll learn the truths of that song and the truths of the message that will come in just a few moments. Father, everything we do should be for your glory and your honor. And Father, that's the utmost prayer that I always have. In your son's name we pray. Amen.
For those of you that do not know, my name is Christian. This is Veronica. We've had the privilege to be able to lead worship at Global, and I've made some awesome friends here. Turn around, wave. This is the Global Lights. And that's what we call ourselves. It's weird. But it's been an awesome experience, been able to work camps, and even better than I thought it would be. I was honestly pretty scared to go in the beginning, but these guys made me feel at home, and been able to see a lot of lives get changed, including our own, and it's been awesome working together and encouraging each other to fully pursue what God has in store. And especially with our youth here, being able to see them change, being able to see them grow into leaders that we're called to be in the church. And this is one of our songs that we lead each week, and I want y'all to sing it with us when you feel comfortable singing. This is Waymaker.
You are here working in this worship you. You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you. I worship you.
That is who you are. You are way made.
seated. I am so glad that our God is a way maker, amen. And matter of fact, He is the way, the truth, and the life. And no man can come into the Father except by the Lord Jesus Christ. I want you to take your Bibles, and we're going to just look quickly at a couple of truths out of 2 Kings chapter number 5. I don't have a PowerPoint. I'm not going to preach very long. 45 minutes, we'll be out of here. And what a blessing that's going to be. Amen? Just kidding. 2 Kings 5, and one of the great stories, probably familiar with all of you, is the account of the Old Testament of the story of Naaman the leper. Naaman the leper. I love this story. It's one of my favorite, probably, stories in all of the Old Testament. Let's just read a few verses beginning in chapter 1 of Naaman, chapter number, or verse 1 of Naaman of 2 Kings chapter 5. Now Naaman, captain of the host of the kings of Syria, was a great man, with his master and honorable, because by him the Lord had given deliverance unto Syria. He was also a mighty man in valor, but he was a leper. And the Syrians had gone out by companies and had brought away captive out of the land of Israel a little maid, and she waited on Naaman's wife. And she said unto her mistress, "Would God, my Lord, were with the prophet that is in Samaria, for he would recover him of his leprosy." And one went in and told his Lord, saying, "Thus and thus said the maid that is in the land of Israel." And the king of Syria said, Go, and I will send a letter unto the king of Israel." And he departed and took with him 10 talents of silver, 6,000 pieces of gold, 10 changes of raiment, about $4 million in our currency today. About $4 million is what he took with him. And he brought the letter to the king of Israel, saying, "Now when this letter is coming to thee, behold, I have therewith sent Naaman, my servant, to thee, that thou mayest recover him of his leprosy." You know, I love this story, and I guess one of the reasons that I love it so much is there are so many biblical truths and so many pictures that you can draw out of this story. One of the things that you note, first of all, is the fact that Naaman is a great man with a great problem. He's a great man with a great problem. Notice what the scripture says. It says, for instance, that he was the captain of the host of Syria. That means he was the chief of staff for the armies of the Syrian nation. Now, of course, Syria was just to the north of Israel. They were the arch enemies of Israel. Later on, they would come down and they would totally take captive Israel, and eventually they would be conquered by Babylon, and Babylon would take Judah. But we're talking about a man who was a great man. He had a very influential position. He was the Schwarzenegger, if you lived in that day, of Syria, a 4-star general at the least, and possibly even a 5-star. He was honorable. That means he was highly regarded. We're also told by him that the Lord had given deliverance unto Syria. Now keep in mind, Syria was a pagan nation. They weren't the chosen nation of God, but God uses this man to give that pagan nation victory over its enemies. You know, we're in a political year, a year that we're going to vote, and I think it's always important for you and me to realize that it is God who is always behind the scenes, putting up and setting down those that He will. You and I have a responsibility to vote, there's no doubt about it. But when it comes to the United States of America, when it comes to other nations around the world, there's one very important thing for us to remember, that behind all of that is the sovereignty and the providence of God. He is, as the song says, always working. He is always working, putting up those whom He would and putting down those that He would. And I guess it's one of the greatest comforts and rest that we have as believers and Christians is the fact that we can rest no matter what may be going on in the nations of the world or even in our nation. We can rest in the providence and in the sovereignty of God. And the fact, now listen to this, that our God has a plan. And He has revealed much of that plan to us in the Bible. Just study through the book of Daniel. Read the book of Revelation and 2 Thessalonians. You can just study through the scripture and understand in 2 Peter that God has a plan for the nations of the world and even for this nation. And listen, He even has a plan for the heavens and the earth around us. One of these days, He's going to destroy it and create a new heaven and a new earth. But I want you to know that he is sovereign in all that he does. Naaman also was a mighty man of valor. He was a warrior. I think about often in the Bible, you see army leaders coming to faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. You see Cornelius, and you see different ones that, listen, they weren't sissified guys. These were tough men, the Philippian jailer. And these people gave their heart and life to Christ. And all of these things, this mighty warrior, this honorable man, this chief of staff for an entire nation, he had a great problem, though he was a great man. He had leprosy. Leprosy. Verse number one, but he was a leper. And all the other things that were said about him, listen, this right here almost negates it all, because he would have suffered what so many people in that day suffered. It was the AIDS of their day. There was no cure. There was no hope for someone who had leprosy apart from a miracle. Whenever you study about leprosy and you study about sickness in the Bible, oftentimes God uses it to give us a picture of sin. Let me give you this verse, Isaiah chapter 1 and verse number 6. God is speaking to the nation of Israel, and he says these words, "From the sole of the foot even unto the head, there is no soundness in it, but wounds and bruises and putrefying sores. They have not been closed, neither bound up, neither mollified with ointment." You know what he's saying? He's saying the entire nation is sick. And he gives the picture of it being sick from the top of its head to the soles of their feet. The entire nation was corrupt with impurity and wickedness and uncleanness. Whenever David was writing Psalm 38, he wrote and he used sin, and he used this word to picture sin. He called it a plague. So leprosy all throughout the Bible is pictured as sin. As a matter of fact, you can read in your Bible, everyone say this book of the Bible, Leviticus. This people are with me, these people are not. Leviticus. The book of Leviticus, chapters 13, 14, and 15, literally tell you and give you in depth what God wanted the Levites and the nation of Israel to do if someone had contracted leprosy. Now, I want you to listen to a few things that the scripture tells us about leprosy, the devastation of this sin. One of the things that it does is it just simply spreads. He wrote and he said in Leviticus 13, 21, "If the priest examines it and there is no white hair in it, and it is not deeper than the skin but has faded, then the priest shall shut him up 7 days. But if it spreads in the skin, then the priest shall pronounce him unclean. It is a disease." You know something? Sin spreads. You ever thought about that? You don't have to go very far in your Bible to realize it does. Just go to the book of Genesis. There you have Eve eating of the fruit of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, and then she begins to share it with Adam, and he willfully disobeyed. You go on, and Eve has her first child. She thought he was the promised Messiah that God had spoken of in Genesis chapter 3, verses 15 through 17. The proto-evangelicum, as it is called by theologians. Where from that seed of a woman would come one that would bruise, that would crush the head of the serpent, and the serpent would bruise his heel. You know what that little boy ended up being? A murderer. Sin had spread not just at Adam and Eve, but even to its offspring, as Cain would eventually kill his own brother Abel, and he would become the first martyr in human history. Sin had spread so greatly in the coming centuries that the scripture says this: the earth was filled with wickedness. Sin spreads and contaminates everything it touches. Money is fine, but all of a sudden we begin to love money. And sin comes into the picture. Someone will long for it so much, they'll break the Ten Commandments. They'll kill someone for money. They'll steal money and deceive and lie and do all kinds of things just to satisfy the desire for money. Sports is wonderful, but all of a sudden, sin begins to spread, and we lie, we cheat, we take drugs, all of it just to be able to get ahead. We'll try to fix a game here or there. Medicine, it's wonderful, but sin gets involved and it becomes an escape from reality. All of a sudden, it becomes an addiction. Sin takes over and turns that which could be good into that which is awful and damaging. Such is the devastating effects of sin. And I'm going to tell you this, if you allow sin to run rampant in your life, it will not just spread to you, it'll spread throughout the influences that you have. That's why the psalmist wrote in Psalm 1, blessed is the man, blessed is that lady who walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of the scornful. Why? Because sin spreads. Once they're just standing, next they're participating, and then next they're recruiting others to participate in sin. Oh, if you're a school teacher, you've seen it. If you're an adult and have friends, you've watched it. It could be the coworker beside of you. It could be the person you have under you. But the bottom line, sin's influence begins to spread, and it spreads a lot like leprosy. It's also not just something that spreads, but it also is something that separates. Whenever you read through the book of Leviticus, chapter number 13, you'll find out that God tells them if they have leprosy, the priest, were to declare them unclean, and they had to go outside of the camp. The scripture says in Leviticus 13 and verse 46 that his habitation would be alone outside the camp. If you were to study Jewish history and some of the rabbis, they would tell you that a leper could not come no closer than 6 feet upwind and 150 feet downwind. Sin separates. The first thing it does is it isolates us from God. The scripture says, but your iniquities have separated between you and your God, and your sins have hid his face from you that he will not hear. That even happens in the life of Christians, amen? Not just if you've never trusted Christ, but here we are walking with God, fellowshipping with God, longing for God, and then sin begins to ease in. And sin creates a wall between you and between God. The beautiful book of the Song of Solomon is a picture of the Shunammite woman, the one lady that Solomon loved above everyone else. And oh, they were head over heels in love. I could just see them smooching every once in a while. They loved each other. But I'll tell you, as you study through that book, you'll find that she begins to cry because there's a distance. There is a wall that has come between them. And all of a sudden, the little foxes she describes begin to spoil and eat at the grapes of the vine. And what happens is sin eases in, and it separates our fellowship from God. And sin eases in, and it begins to eat up the fruit that you and I should bear for God. Sin is devastating. It spreads. It separates. And listen, it just doesn't separate us from God, but it also separates us from our families so often. Sin destroys homes. Listen, that little thought of a flirtation that you think nothing about in the workplace, all of a sudden it begins to grow, and it begins to grow, and it begins to grow. Leviticus 14:43 says, and if the plague come again and break out in the house, he shall break down the house, the stones of it, and the timber thereof, and all the mortar of the house, and he shall carry them forth out of the city into an unclean place. When that leprosy got into the home, they took down everything. They didn't leave one thing standing. All of the stones, all of the timber that was used to build that home, they took it outside of the camp, and they burned it with fire. I'll tell you, that's what sin does. It destroys homes. It isolates us from our friends and family. The scripture says that those who had contracted the sin of leprosy had to go outside of the camp. As a matter of fact, the only thing that you ever see that was ever touched with leprosy that took place was it was destroyed with fire. Three times in Leviticus 13, you hear this statement, it shall be burned with fire. Leprosy was only fit for fire. And I'm going to tell you this, those of you who have never trusted Jesus as your Savior and you have the plague of sin in your life, the Bible says that you're a walking dead man, just like I was, and just like everyone who has never trusted Christ as their Savior is. They're living dead in trespasses and in sin. But God, who is rich in mercy, he quickens us. He gives us life. May I tell you, the picture of Naaman the leper is a picture of someone who comes to faith in God and his word alone and trusts and obeys God and his word alone. And guess what? Oh, he's cleansed. He's given his life back. He's washed. The scripture says, if we had time to read through all of it, that his skin was like a little baby's skin. I love babies, don't you? Preachers and politicians are supposed to love babies, and I'm telling you, I love them. They have such soft little skin. Whatever Naaman the leper, if you could just imagine the sores, there are three types of leprosy. Whenever you get it, they begin, the first type, it begins around the joints. Normally it begins around the nose and the lips, and then it'll get around the joints and it begins to spread and it gets larger and larger and ulcer-like. Then there's another type of leprosy that you read about. It's where it affects the nerve endings of the fingers. It begins with the fingers. And you eventually could take a needle and stick it all the way through your finger or through your toe and never feel it. That's why some people lose their limbs, is because they keep hurting themselves because they can't feel anything. And then there's a third type of leprosy that combines both. But can you imagine this man filled with leprosy? This great, honorable man. Well, you're not only introduced to Naaman, who is a great man and a great person with a great problem, but you're also introduced to a precious little maid. And I'm going to tell you, this maid had a heart that was so very big. I don't have time to preach this entire message to you, but I want you to focus on this little maid for a second. Because I'm going to tell you, this maid is what every Christian ought to be. This maid is a picture of what our hearts should be. She had been taken captive by the Assyrian army, and this general had brought her into his home, and she was a maid for this general's wife. Can you imagine? Here she is, pulled from family, from friends, in a foreign town. Can you imagine the anger, the frustration, the bitterness that she probably should have felt, but she had none of it? As a matter of fact, she seemed to almost have a love for this man. And the scripture says in verse number 2, and the Syrian had gone out by companies and had brought away captive out of the land of Israel a little maid, and she waited on Naaman's wife. And she said unto her mistress, would God my Lord were the prophet that is in Samaria, for he would recover him of his leprosy. I want to tell you, I believe she sat back and she looked at the devastating effects of leprosy in the life of this great general. He couldn't hug his wife. He couldn't play with his kids. It had destroyed that home, and the influence of this man was so limited that he'd have to probably give a word and have it delivered, or write a letter, as I believe he did, to the king of Syria. Can you imagine, as she sat there and she looked, her heart just was broken, and she expressed mercy. She expressed it, number one, in a prayer. Oh, Lord God, I want to ask you this. Do you see the devastating effects of sin around you? With the lost all around us that are in bondage to sin, that are struggling, that are making one mistake after another, and not just those that are bound by sin, listen, that are lost, but what about those who are Christians that are living in sin? You would be shocked at what occupies my mind. Do you know that I spend more time and more prayer and more thought meditating on people that I know that are Christians, that are members of our church, that are living in sin, than I do anything else? It is the heaviest burden on my heart, because I know what sin is doing to them. It's robbing them of joy and of peace and all that God wants to give to them, all of the blessings of God that He wants to pour out upon them. And they just have not kept themselves in the love of God. I was so touched to hear some of the testimonies, not just this morning, but even individuals, young people talking to me about what God did in their life. And I thought, oh Lord Jesus, if you can just let them come back, and God somehow or another give them the wisdom to run from sin, because sin steals that joy, and it steals that peace, and it steals that fellowship with God and that usefulness. I'm going to tell you, you better be afraid of one thing, and that's sin. Because sin will hurt your heart, and it'll hurt the heart of your family. She expressed mercy and compassion. She cared about this man. The psalmist David wrote one time and he said, "No one cared for my soul. No one even cared." I wonder, do we care for the souls of Murray County? Do we care for the souls of our neighbor and our family and our friends? Do we care? She not only expressed mercy, but she also shared a message. She said, "Would God, my Lord, were with the prophet in Samaria, for he would recover him of his leprosy." Let me tell you what she did. She shared the only thing she knew. She said, "There is a prophet. His name," but maybe she knew it, maybe she didn't, "is Elisha. And oh, that Naaman was able to get to that man, because I believe he could heal him of leprosy." Oh, she knew where the cure was, and we know where the cure is. We have this treasure in earthen vessels, and the treasure is the gospel of Jesus Christ. We have the greatest message to share, and the only message that will heal a world of sin and all of the looting and all of the violence and all of the problems that permeate our society and world. They are cured with the healing balm of Gilead and with the gospel of Jesus Christ, which is the power of God into salvation. Psalm 119 and verse 46 says, "I will speak of thy testimonies also before kings and will not be ashamed." What a marvelous statement. I am not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, because it is the power of God into salvation. Paul wrote to young Timothy, probably 38 to 40 years old, and he was vacillating in his walk with God. He was struggling in 2 Timothy, and he wrote to him in 2 Timothy, and he said, "Do not be ashamed of the gospel. Do not be ashamed of Jesus Christ, nor of me, his servants." Oh, listen, Timothy was being ashamed a little bit. And all of us go through those things sometimes. But oh, this lady wasn't. She spoke of the Lord before kings. And so Naaman writes a letter to the king himself. Verse 5, he gets up $4 million worth of gold and silver, and he carries it down to Elisha. Actually, they take it to the king of Israel, and the king of Israel is scared to death that they're going to kill him if they don't heal this man. He's afraid he's going to put him to war. And he's like, "Who am I? What am I to do with leprosy?" Amen. It's kind of like you and I. What are we to do with sin? That's a God-sized problem. Amen. Only God can deal with that. So you know the story. Naaman makes his way down with all of that great entourage that was probably around him to probably a little old dwelling of Elisha. And Elisha just sends out his servant and tells him, "I want you to go wash in the Jordan River 7 times, and your flesh will come again to thee, and you will be clean." Verse number 10. And Naaman was madder than a red hen. I've heard that all my life. I wonder if red hens get madder than white ones. I'm not sure. But wet hen, maybe it is. Wet cats get mad, but I don't know about wet hens. He got mad. He says, "Well, I've got beautiful streams and rivers that flow back home in Syria. As a matter of fact, from those snow-capped mountains, as they begin to melt, there's a cool and there's a clear rivers," and he names two of them. He said, "Why couldn't I go there?" And his servant said, "Well, listen, listen. If he had asked you to do some great thing, like go conquer an army, you would have been glad to do it. But what about just this? Let's just go do this thing." And he did. D.L. Moody said that Naaman lost his temper, he lost his pride, and he lost his leprosy. And salvation normally comes that way. Oftentimes people lose their temper when they hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. They don't want to be told they're sinners. They don't want to be told there's a hell. And then eventually, through the work of the Spirit of God, they begin to lose their pride and they humble themselves and come as a child and place their faith and trust in Jesus Christ. And they lose the leprosy of sin when they do that. Amen. They lose it. He goes and he dips 7 times in the Jordan River. And you know what? He comes up and his skin, that 7th time, is just as soft as a baby skin. Not a mark on it. Just beautiful. Donald Gray Barnhouse, the great theologian, many years ago made this statement: everybody has the privilege of going to heaven God's way or going to hell their own way. There was only one way that Naaman was going to be healed of his leprosy, and that was to obey the word of God. The word that God had given through that prophet, and listen to me, there's only one way that you'll be healed of sin, and that is to obey the word of God and call upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and be saved. There is only one way, and that's through Jesus. And Peter put it like this before the Supreme Court of Israel. He stood before the Sanhedrin and he said these words: there is no other name under heaven given among men whereby you must be saved. Jesus said, I'm the only way. There's only one way, and it's through faith in Christ. Do you know what that $4 million represented? It represented human achievement, someone attempting to gain or earn their way to heaven some other way than God's way. I want to tell you, that is the religions of the world. It is the way of human achievement. They are attempting to approach God some other way than the way God has instructed. And then there's the way of divine accomplishment, as many of you have heard. Divine accomplishment is what Jesus accomplished on the cross. Do you realize in the book of Isaiah there is a righteousness that the scripture says God created? It's not a righteousness that you and I have of our own, but it's literally a righteousness that God himself has created. And that righteousness is an everlasting righteousness. It will never, ever, ever go away. It is a righteousness that will sustain all of eternity, and it's given to you and to me as a gift through faith in Jesus Christ. Pretty powerful. And then you have Naaman giving us just a beautiful picture of what happens to those who have trusted Christ as their Savior. Look at verse number 15. It says, Naaman has said, there is no God in all the earth but in Israel. I pray thee, take a blessing of thy servant. He goes over 50 miles out of the way. Over 50 miles he went out of the way to go back to see Elisha just to thank him. How many of you have called the people that had a major influence in your life, who led you to Christ, or who was influential in influencing you for Christ? How many of you have just called and thanked them? Remember one night about 3 a.m. I woke up. I do that quite often, and we were living in Knoxville, Tennessee, and I just could not get, normally when I get up that early, the Lord has something for me to pray about, and I was praying, and I just couldn't get off of my heart the man that led my mom and dad to the Lord. My dad's dad left him. He was raised by his mother only, and then eventually she married someone, but dad had to sit at a dining room table at his uncle's, the dining room table. My dad and his Uncle Johnny weren't allowed to sit at. They were called bastard kids because their dad left them. They had to sit in another room to eat. My mom's mother died when she was 1 year old, and her father put her on the front doorsteps of her grandmother and left, and we've never known him. And God brought those two people together. There was one man who led both my mom and dad to the Lord. I think about how I could have been in a home where there was beer and alcohol flowing and where people were beating and cussing and lying and stealing and all kinds of things. And I think about the fact that Jesus brought peace and joy and purpose into my mom and dad's. And I can't tell you the hundreds of times, and I'm not kidding when I say hundreds, where I had fallen asleep on a pew of a church listening to preaching. Or I would go home and I'd fall asleep in the back of that LTD. You remember those cars? Boy, I wish they still made those. Maybe they do. Big old LTD, and I could sleep back there. Dad would pick me up, carry me in, put me in my bed, and I'd get up, eat cereal. Dad would be in his study reading the Bible. I remember at 3 a.m. thinking about that man. I called him and I said, listen, I said, I'm going to take you down to Atlanta to your favorite suit shop, and I'm going to buy you a couple of suits. It's one of the best days I've ever spent in my life. You ought to take the people sometime who've influenced you for God and for Christ. You ought to take a Sunday school teacher, maybe an elementary school teacher that really impacted your life for Christ. You ought to thank them. He expressed appreciation. He wanted to give him something. And then he said this. Verse 17, Naaman said, "Shall there not then, I pray thee, be given to thy servants two mules, burdens of earth, for thy servants will henceforth not offer neither burnt offering nor sacrifice unto the other gods, but unto the Lord." He said, "I want you to know something." He said, "I don't want to just express my appreciation by thanking you and offering you something." He said, "But I want you to know," he wanted to take some dirt back to Israel, from Israel. He was so grateful for the land that he had been cleansed in. And oh, listen, this man trusted Christ. He got saved this day. Naaman, I believe with all my heart, is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Sometime you and I'll walk the street of gold with Naaman in a land where leprosy will be no more and sin will be no more. And he said, "I want you to know that I'm going to only worship the one true God." He not only wanted to express appreciation by giving, he wanted to express appreciation by worship and thanksgiving. Oh, I'm going to tell you, when your heart is filled with the love of God and the power of the Holy Spirit, you'll sing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. You'll make melody in your heart unto God. There'll be a song in the night. There'll be a song in the morning and a song during the day, just out of appreciation for all that God's done. You say, "Pastor Mark, what do we want to take home with this?" Well, that precious maid. Oh, let's ask the Lord to give us a heart that is compassionate and merciful toward people that are living in sin, that God would open up our eyes. Listen, folks, it is so easy for us to deal with each other in here. Amen? It is so easy for us to... We know each other, we love each other, we care about each other. But listen, our mission is not in these walls only ministering one another. Our great mission is out there where people are lost and dying and they have the leprosy of sin. And they need healed from that plague. And they need to go to the Crimson Flow, not to the Jordan River, and be washed by the blood of the Lamb. Have the message. It could just be your testimony. I went down to the beach this last week, and Sherry and the kids were down on the beach, and so I did what most men do. I went to Dillard's and shot. So they had a wonderful sale on at Dillard's, and I was in there, and there was a man, and he was helping me. We were looking at suits, and he was helping me. And I asked him, "I've got to go." I said, "But can I tell you a story?" He said, "Yes, I'd love to hear it." 12 years old, I went to a youth camp in North Georgia. I said, on Thursday night of that youth camp, I placed my faith and trust in Jesus Christ as my Savior. And I said, "I want you to know that it changed my life." I said, "I'm not worried about dying, going to hell." I said, "I know I'm going to go to heaven someday." I said, "What about you?" I had to go back the next day because I forgot to get some socks. He said, "I thought a lot about what you said yesterday." I said, "You can trust Christ as your Savior. We have the message. Do we have the mercy?" She initiated a miracle. She probably wasn't even there to see it, but her compassion and her message initiated a miracle. And I want you to know, your compassion and your message may initiate the miracle of salvation if you'll just be willing to testify before kings. Let's pray. Father, thank you for the opportunity to be in this place, to worship, to hear the testimonies of our youth, to be able to hear the wonderful message and song. Oh, Lord, thank you for Naaman the leper. Thank you for all the lessons he teaches us. How that there are people all around us. Lord, sin has devastated their lives, whether they know it or not. There is so much more that life has to offer. God, help us to walk in the footsteps of a little maiden girl. God, give us the compassion to think more than just what's going on in our little world, but to think about what's going on in the world of people all around us, and help us to be willing to share that message, the message of how Jesus went outside the camp and bore the sin of man. We love you, Heavenly Father, and we thank you for how good you have been to us. And forgive us for not loving you the way we should. Forgive us for not loving others the way we should. And put a fire in our hearts. Stir us. Revive us again, O Lord, that our hearts might rejoice in thee. We love you and thank you for it. In Jesus' name we do pray. Amen and amen. We're going to have one verse of invitation. I want you to stand. If you need to come and pray for any reason, I want to invite you to come. She's going to play, and I'm going to lip sync. You come if you need to pray about anything, because Jesus is calling today. Thank you, Miss Tina. She can play, can't you? I'll tell you what we want to do to try to honor this social distancing thing we've got going on. We would like for our ushers to begin to dismiss us by rows, if you don't mind. So we'll probably begin in the back and make our way out. And Tina, she may keep playing for us. And we appreciate you being here. God bless all of you.